Welcome to another episode of Lizeth Invita. I'm Lizeth Cruz Huarco, your host. Today, I have a good friend of mine coming over. Her name is Banu Valladares. She is a complete artist. She's a poet, she's written books, she's an actress, she was a model, and now she works in the humanities. So join us as we have Pabellón Criollo. I'm waiting for Banu to get here, but in the meantime, I'm going to start making the carne mechada for the Pabellón Criollo. Pabellón Criollo basically means a combination of foods that make the Venezuelan national dish, which is rice, black beans, maduros or sweet plantains, and carne mechada, which is shredded beef. So we're going to start making the carne mechada. I'm going to turn on my stove, and this is flank steak. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna brown it. I have seasoned it prior with salt, pepper, and some cumin. Nothing fancy for now. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna brown these, and then we're going to start cutting up all our ingredients and putting them in the carne mechada. So as you can see, I've been cutting up some of my vegetables that I'm going to add, some ingredients, and then my meat has been searing for about 5 minutes on each side. You can see, it's nice and seared. I'm going to take it out, and then what I'm going to do is start putting in all my vegetables. A tablespoon of olive oil in the pan, and this is the same pan that I was using to braise the meat. Let's go with the sazon and the onion. So I've got one large onion, 2 tablespoons of sazon, 2 garlic cloves, and 1 red bell pepper. And we're gonna let this sweat out a little bit. And we'll add the tomatoes and the cilantro and the Worcestershire sauce in just a little bit. I'm turning up the heat first, and then I'm gonna add the tomatoes, the cilantro leaves, because I wanna leave them whole because I'm gonna take these out later. And I'm gonna put 2 tablespoons of Worcestershire sauce. Salsa inglesa in Spanish. That's about 1. That's about 2. let's let this incorporate, and then I'm gonna put it back in, and we're gonna let it cook down for about 2 hours, or where the meat is super tender and we can then shred it. I'm gonna put some broth in here. What I want is to cover the meat with the broth or with water. And I'm also gonna add a little bit more of cumin, salt, and pepper just to make sure that everything is nice and seasoned. Last thing I want to make sure is that my meat is completely submerged, and we're going to make sure that we cover the meat and not touch it until we feel like it's ready to be shredded. You want all those juices to stay in there. So it'll be about a couple hours before I see you again. So guys, just like I promised, my friend Banu is here. Hola, mi amor.
Hola, ¿qué tal? Muchas gracias.
Ay, no, gracias a ti por venir.
Qué rico.
Bilingual, Spanish, English, sí. What do you want?
Perfect, we can do it in English.
Okay, chévere.
Or bilingual.
Whatever comes out, I'll put the subtitles in later.
Yes.
So we've been cooking the meat now for 2 hours, and now we're going to start shredding it. So is this something you ate a lot in Venezuela when you were a kid?
Yeah, this is our staple, particularly around Christmas time.
Ah.
Pabellón. And I have some really great memories about this because we would go out party, right? Christmas, particularly New Year's, we would go out party all night and like stay until the next morning and then end up at some bar and they would have pabellón, which you needed because you've been dancing and drinking.
Yeah. You need the energy from the beef, right?
Yes, we loved it. Pabellón and caraotas.
That's
what we call them.
Black beans. Or habichuelas negras. Mm-hmm. Or como quieras.
Rice and plátanos. Mm-hmm. Plátanos fritos.
So we're having the pabellón criollo.
Mm-hmm. My favorite.
So tell me, how was it growing up in Venezuela? Well, you know, what are like those childhood memories you have that are the most prevalent that kind of come to you once in a while, you know, you're like, oh, I remember that.
You know, the funniest thing is the majority of my memories are around food. So I grew up with my grandmother. I mean, my mom was at home, but mom worked. Mm-hmm. And my grandma was the person who came and took care of us while mom was at work.
Mm-hmm.
And she was an amazing cook. So this particular smell was a very familiar smell for me. So I have, from a very early age, memories of the smells of stew meat, cooking. And plátanos frying, and arepas. The cornmeal cakes.
Mm-hmm.
Later on, you know, when mom and dad would go travel, my grandma, La Mama, used to stay as well. And she would wake up very early in the morning and brew coffee.
Mm.
And that smell of coffee coming up. And I associate food and the smell of food with my grandmother's love.
Aww.
So I'm always thinking that this is the
best
most nurturing.
Kind of love.
It is,
completely.
And then to eat something wonderful. So I also have memories of loving doing dishes.
Mm.
Because it kept me in the kitchen with my grandma.
Oh.
And so, you know, you get to play with water.
Sure, make bubbles.
That's
wonderful.
Several people tell me, I can't believe that you like doing dishes. Like, it's an association with love and, here's this woman that really took good care of me. I have this other memory of being very, very little. So I guess there was a little playpen next to the kitchen.
Mm-hmm.
So my grandma would be cooking over there and, you know, I would be in a little playpen on the side. And I remember trying to get myself out.
Wanting
to go over to my grandma.
Yeah, you were one of those kids.
I was that kid, yeah.
Like, and we're going to let the meat kind of soak in all the soupy stuff, all the juices that we have built up for these last 2-3 hours of cooking the meat. And then we're going to come back and serve it. Bueno, acabamos de cenar. We just finished eating. And I'm going to sit here with Banu and ask her a couple questions and see if we can get to know her a little better. What do you guys think? I like the idea. So, Banu, we were talking during cooking about your childhood and how food brought you to that place where you felt loved, comfortable. Is there any other space in your life that makes you feel that way that has brought you to that same feeling?
As opposed to the kitchen.
As opposed to the kitchen.
That's a really good question. Definitely, that's a really, so literature, right? It's one of those spaces that has allowed me to, so when I moved here, I was fluent in English, but I was not constantly thinking in English, right? Mm-hmm. So I had, you had to go through that process of finding your voice. In English,
And as the process went and I became more fluent and I started dreaming in English, I became very confused about who I was, right? So was I the person that spoke English or was I the person who spoke Spanish? And because a lot of my identity, part of my grandmother's upbringing, there was not only cooking, but there was storytelling. And so I was surrounded by story. And so part of my identity has to do with stories about who I am and my grandmother's stories. And when I started speaking a new language and I didn't have histories or stories in that language, it was very confusing to me, you know, so who am I? And literature allowed me to explore that. So writing became this home space where I could understand what I was thinking and be able to begin to bridge those two. Somebody once said to me, it was one of my professors said, when you speak two languages, you are like a snail, but you have two separate shells that you can go into. And when you become fully bilingual, you create a tunnel between the two. So what you're looking for is have the ease of moving from one language to the other, right? And so I always thought that literature and writing gave me that place where I could begin to explore who am I here, and how do the two connect.
Do you sometimes in different stages find yourself in one shell
completely
than the other?
Yeah. You know what's really interesting? Of course, I have very clear memories of my childhood, and those are coded in Spanish. So if I want to talk about that part of my childhood, my English gets pretty confused. So my language gets a little broken or more hesitant, or you hear the accent a little bit thicker because somehow that it's coded, right?
So, right.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So I remember us talking off camera and you were telling my family and I at the dinner table how you actually came to the United States to study computer science. How did you go from computer science, get a load of this, computer science to literature, English and arts and poetry and all that?
So it's almost like, it's probably more like a circle, because I started out in the arts, right? So I was little and I was doing theater and singing and creating plays and acting in plays and all of that. However, at the same time that all of that is happening, I'm studying math, and I have a really good teacher in middle school who sees the potential and begins to push me further. And math becomes this beautiful language, and I don't know, there was something very rhythmic and delightful about it. And I was challenged, so these whole worlds were opening up for me in math and also in chemistry. And because I love math so much, then I went into the sciences and the computer science. And so when I was a freshman, I took my first English class, and I was taking differential calculus, which is a beautiful class, but it was very challenging. And I found literature, and we were doing a lot of reading and writing, and writing was easy. And I don't know, you all of a sudden, there are these other worlds that are opening for you.
Comfortable?
Right? Very comfortable. And it's really strange because obviously I was very comfortable in Spanish and in Spanish literature. But there was the beauty of the conciseness of the English language, right? In writing, when you're composing, and there's this pattern to a really good composition. And then for poetry, the compactness of that, I was like, changing majors. And I never looked back until, you know, just recently going, what would have happened? But it's strange how life, you know, you think that you're headed in some direction and then something beautiful happens and opens up and you can't help but follow. Yeah.
Banu, after changing your major to literature, and graduating from the university, where did that take you?
That's such a great question, because I bounced quite a bit, right?
Did you?
I did. So my very first job, I was proofreader at an accounting firm. My. How random is that, right? So I hated that job because, you know, I spent 4 years studying literature, mm-hmm. and, you know, entering these worlds that helped me understand all kinds of different people. And I was reading accounting language. So from lawyers, basically, right? It was really poorly written English, right. You know, very repetitive, kind of, and very convoluted because it was lawyer speak. And then looking at numbers. And I remember every day leaving that job and saying, if I died today and I would know what that was like, I would be really angry. I would be so angry that I wasted my life, right? I would leave work and it would be dark outside and I'd say, I just never do this kind of work, right? I need to be doing some more creative work. So I bounced quite a bit. I worked as I was married to a photographer and I ran his business and I sold for him. So I was a business rep. But really the thing that, the pattern became teaching. Hmm. So any number of, I taught English as a second language, Spanish in elementary school, Spanish at the community college level, and did any number of things, acting and modeling. And
so tell me about that. How do you go from teaching to acting or modeling? Now, I can see the modeling. You're a beautiful lady. But acting, not everybody can do.
So the acting was something that I had done in Venezuela. And actually, my preference would have been to do acting when I got here. But my accent was pretty thick, mm-hmm. really thick. To where, you know, in one of my classes, I took a speech class. We had to tape ourselves. And I got to hear myself back on tape, right? I was like, oh my God, that's the way that I sound, right? So I went to a class, private lessons with this woman who actually put her finger in my mouth so that I could do the D's and the T's, which are uh-huh. really hard sounds in English sure. from Spanish, yes. and the other way around, correct. Right? So so actually my option at the time was then to do silent stuff, which was modeling. So I did a lot of commercials, no lines. And it took a long time to get lines because of the accent. And also, you know, that was back in the 80s where there wasn't a heck of a lot of need for a Latino mm-hmm. anything, right? Mm-hmm. It was either black or white. Mm-hmm. And Latino was just not a... So I fit that great demographic because I was ambiguous enough that, well, maybe she is Middle Eastern and maybe she is black or she's that other... Right.
Yeah.
Eventually, over time, right, when, like I said, you could see that transition in probably the buy-in power of mm-hmm. Latinos. Mm-hmm. And so I started playing, so the transition was playing the unwed mother, where people would say, would you take your wedding ring off so that you have a kid, but you don't have a ring, you know, telling sure. the story of the unwed mother, to I am a golfer. And I'm in this huge house, and you know, which was I really love seeing that transition sure. of that Latino buying power to then eventually getting to the place where the lines came in. And my very first movie mm-hmm. was really through a friend who in the Latino Credit Union. It was actually Angelica's Dreams.
That's right.
Which was this whole other, mm-hmm. right? This mm-hmm. whole other yes. film. That was just a big soap opera. And how does this woman come to want to buy a home, and et cetera. So
right. Yeah, because you also did Nuestro Barrio.
That's right. I did. I did yeah. both. Nuestro
Barrio. That was more financial literacy, that's right?
Yeah.
Then you get into being more of a, I wouldn't say an art curator, but I would say maybe more of a community arts curator, in a sense.
Yeah, so I you know, the formal job title is administrator, mm-hmm. right? So, and that also happened, so the other side of my trajectory, so I taught. I also taught university, and my last year of teaching university, I taught 3 years, freshman comp, you know, not finding the right fit. I was offered an opportunity to be a teaching artist with through the North Carolina Arts Council mm-hmm. at a time when Luis Rodriguez, a fairly well-known Mexican writer, came to North Carolina to do a long, month-long residency across the state. And I was selected to be a North Carolina Latina to be part of this residency.
Like a fellow artist to him?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And really the majority of my work was actually watch him do his work, which really was very inspiring. So he went into the classrooms and taught writing, but creative writing only. And mm-hmm. I had been teaching academic writing. And when I saw that, I was like, oh, that's what I want to be doing, mm-hmm. right? So that kind of led in that trajectory of how do you become a teaching artist? How do you teach in the classrooms? How do you bring literature into the classroom as a visiting artist, to writing grants, and in the grants then bringing in an evaluator, bringing in a filmmaker, and before I knew it, I was really administering grants, and then that led into a position as an arts administrator with the Durham Arts Council. That was my very first gig.
Right. Official. Yeah. She's official now.
And that led to the rest of my career now as an administrator in the Arts and Humanities.
How do you see the state of Latino arts, but also the Latino community right now in North Carolina?
Yeah, it's been an evolution, right? So, you know, got here in the 80s and the Latino community was more spread out, less organized. So the trajectory has been into more organized groups to a place where there is a little bit of recognition of Latino arts. And I think that, you know, with your work through the Amandig, I'm getting to some really solid presentations of high quality Latino arts across the state, also in Charlotte, community, but now the political climate is challenging, right, and requires a new vision for how we work together, and maybe requires that we work together more intentionally now to figure out what is the message that we can present through the arts and the humanities.
Yeah. I don't know how you feel, but I feel that maybe the arts is the one place that we can find some common ground. Is that how you feel?
And I think, you know, yeah, exactly. That everybody has some sort of tradition that somebody else can relate to, you know. So there's weaving, and just about everybody weaves, right? And then there's dancing, and just about every culture dances, right? So, and there are these experiences that you can have through the arts and the humanities where you can transcend the moment mm-hmm. and enter into something larger. It's what I was saying about literature, right? You can enter a whole other world where the issue is presented, but it's not you and I. It's happening to somebody else, and we can be once removed mm-hmm. from the issue, but still explore it and then talk about mm-hmm. it. So it creates less tension between sure. you and I, and gives us an entry point. The arts do the exact same way, right? It gives us a vehicle for us to come together and experience something. So last night I was at a party, at a birthday party, and at some point in the night there was a group of young Latinos in the living room, and the one was playing the piano, and this woman picked up a guitar, and this other guy picked up a guitar, and all of a sudden they were all singing mm-hmm. songs that they knew. I didn't know these songs, they're younger, you know, they're newer songs.
Gotcha.
But I got to watch a community come together at a time when there's a lot of threat and mm-hmm. fear,
right.
And that was all transcended through the power of music. And then the other people flooded into the room,
mm-hmm.
American, you know, people mm-hmm. and from people from all other places, and enjoyed the music and dance. It was beautiful.
Right.
And I think that that's the power that the arts have to help us create a lens for possibility.
Now, funding has always been an issue for Latino arts in the community. Yeah. Do you foresee that it'll be tougher or easier to fund Latino causes, issues, events, art forms.
Yeah, I think that more than ever, we now need the community at large to rally around advocacy, the NEH and the National Endowment for the Humanities and the National Endowment for the Arts are both threatened to be cut. Their budgets are threatened to be cut, and the majority of the arts and culture that are taking place in the state are largely funded by those two national agencies. So if that funding gets cut, then the state funding for the arts, all the arts, gets cut, which also translates to Latino arts. And so I think that it's a time when corporations and individuals, if they value Latino arts expression, need to come to the foreground and support organizations and groups that are doing this work and doing it well.
It doesn't look great, I know.
Right.
But where do you think we can go? Where do you think we will go? Let's say in the next 5 years.
The arts?
Yes.
Latino arts and culture? I'm very hopeful, actually. Mm-hmm. So this is what we know about traditional arts, right? The traditional arts, these are the arts that require no funding from anybody, right? It's what these young people were doing. Mm-hmm. It's the popular music, it's the ballads that we knew from the boleros, it's all of that, mm-hmm. right? That people have an investment in, and then they will continue to thrive. I have a feeling that the community will rally, and I don't think that the arts are going to go away. They are an essential expression of who we are, and they survive, the expressions survive regardless of funding. And I think that that's actually what we need to be doing, is mm-hmm. figuring out as organizations how they move from the dependency of funding to transferring the ownership to the people.
To people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it would be a really sad day if the arts are gone.
Yeah. I understand.
There would be no color, no dancing, no, you know.
Well, some people like that, though. Some people would like it to be no color.
To be gone.
To be gone or no color. Yeah. But unfortunately, I think as human beings, we search
for.
We
lean to that. Yeah. I mean, isn't that what we started doing early on? The second we had some intelligence, we started creating beauty in caves, right? There was, and so maybe you didn't want to make it, but you look at it and you appreciate it, right? Mm-hmm. It brings something, some sort of connection to something more sublime than your everyday. And for us, I think as people to survive, we need some sort of glimpse at something larger than ourselves, which the arts gives.
So personally, what do the arts bring to you as a person? What is it, that emotion? What is it emote in you?
Yeah, I mean, you can tell that for me, it's like, if there's no art, I would probably die. I mean, you kind of will. I'm very musical. I have this library of songs in my head. So if you say something, I'll immediately think of a song that has that phrase in it.
Sure.
Love to dance, right? So for me, and then as a writer, you know, when I was more actively writing, it does give me that connection with who I am and whatever that essential piece of me. Mm-hmm. But also I can stand in front of a painting and be thoroughly lost. It's a connection to something larger than my everyday running from A to B, right? And I don't believe that, for me, that there's this, the time is really linear. That's something that we invented, and the arts give us an opportunity to pause and create this extended space in time. Like it happened last night when that group of people were singing, time stopped. And we were just all very present in this rich moment of communion. That's, I mean, I can't imagine life without it. So, yeah.
Where do you see art taking you? Not where's taking the community, but where's it taking you?
This is really interesting because I moved from being like an artist to an administrator. Mm-hmm. And so that's been going really well, but as I'm getting older, looking at that point in that direction, because it feels like the grave is in that direction. Getting older, that seems youth, and this seems like the elder time. I'm realizing that the place now is to begin to find leadership and to begin to mentor the younger generations on how to do this work. Mm-hmm. The administrative work, but not the administrative work of filling out paperwork, but really of advocacy, the advocacy work that continues to create opportunities for everybody around mm-hmm. the arts in the state.
So in an ideal world, what would that look like?
In the dream, and the big dream for the state, I would so love to have a Latino Arts Council. I just think that maybe we have the NALAC regional that is here, or you know, mm-hmm. some sort of other form of an organization that has some sort of central capacity to fund the presence of the arts in the state at a high level. That would be pretty awesome. And we have like a lot of young practitioners that are making a living wage and have ways to present their work, and people are participating in the arts. So it's not just this organization, but there is a rich presence of Latino arts in the state, and people are really interested in learning about this culture and the ways that we can learn from each other through learning about our cultures.
So what's next for Ivana?
Well, I think that work of coaching, mentoring the younger ones is probably the next step. And there may still be a movie or two in there.
Well, thank you so much
for coming over. So great to see you.
I really appreciate it. I hope you appreciate it.
I was just going to say, the greatest food. It was the best pabellón ever.
She's lying, but that's okay.
Mm-hmm, she's a great
I really thank you so much.
Muchas gracias.
Y por favor, tenemos que hacerlo de nuevo.
Yes, we do.
We have to do this again. Thank you guys for watching. I'm Lizeth Cruz Huarco with Banu Valladares. Thank you. See you next time here on Lizeth Invita.
Thanks for watching. Don't forget to like this page. Oh, and follow me on social media at Lizeth Invita. Remember, subscribe to my YouTube channel. See you next time.